She can kill with a smile, she can wound with her eyes, and she can ruin your faith with her casual lies. And she only reveals what she wants you to see. She hides like a child, but she's always a woman to me.
Welcome, audience. Welcome, Billy Joel fans. This is Timothy Melbinger, professor of music, Penn State University, United States of America, recording on the first day of July 2021. This is the channel in which I talk about notes, rhythms, harmonies, patterns, groupings, things in the music that are there to support the lyrics. Now, don't get me wrong, the lyrics are important, and then we're going to begin there. But the best songs, the songs that endure almost every time, have music that is strong. It supports the themes of the lyrics and does something that makes it, gives it somewhat of a sacred status, something you want to go back to again and again and listen for more and more within it. Okay, so without going into the full introduction about, sacred music, let's move on to today's song. It's called She's Always a Woman by Billy Joel. So he released his wildly popular album, The Stranger, in 1977. It was really the beginning of his popularity. I mean, he burst onto the scene with Piano Man 4 years before that, but it really wasn't until The Stranger, and then after that, a string of albums after that, where he became, somewhat godlike in the rock and roll era. He recorded it then at A&R Studios in New York with Phil Ramone as the producer. And Joel, of course, is the songwriter and the pianist and singer. But there are other musicians here. Hugh McCracken and Steve Berg play acoustic guitars in this song. Doug Stegmaier plays bass, and a man named Richie Cannata plays flute. No percussion this time, and actually that makes for a more intimate setting. He has plenty of rockers, I know, and loud stuff, and sometimes very exciting. This song is generally soft. So let's get into the lyrics. This song describes a tough, modern woman who may put off other people, but somehow seems to have a soft spot in her heart for Joel, or at least Joel has accepted her. And either way, Joel seems to be saying that she is a model of femininity, or perhaps one of several possible models of femininity at the time. So he's actually describing his current wife, who was his manager and supposedly driving a hard bargain at the time, which would end up paying off for him. But, so it's a love song of sorts. Now, he would divorce her in 82 and marry Christie Brinkley, whom he would divorce in 95 or something like that. And then he would marry someone else. You know what I'm getting at. Okay, back to the song. Now, read on their own, the lyrics, you would expect the music to be more aggressive to support them. For example, in just the first line, she can kill with a smile. She can wound with her eyes. I mean, this could be heavy metal, right? What might support the killing and wounding? Well, he's able to counter each potentially sociopathic trait with something that's more gentle and innocent and redeeming about her personality. So, at the very least, she's a complex character, and I think she would take time to get to know. Now, he's, of course, married to this woman, but I'm going to suspect that the song has made it through so many years, partially, at least thinking about just the lyrics here. Because, look, the 1970s were, an important time for feminism. And I think he's describing a multifaceted approach to womanhood here. She doesn't have to be perfect in a single set of ways. In fact, she's She's masculine, perhaps, in some ways, or tough in ways that perhaps might not be forgivable in a different age, but that's what she is, and I think he's trying to say get used to it. So it's a feminist ode in some respects. So that was a big deal in the 70s, and think about it, it really has been ever since. I'm not sure it's ever really let up. He would continue writing songs with themes like this in later albums. There's a song called Stiletto, Uptown Girl, and That's Not Her Style. And I think men can look at the lyrics and think about a woman they know, or maybe a woman to which they are married, and feel, yeah, that's my woman. Or women can look at this song, can hear the lyrics here and say, oh yeah, that's me. Or at least hear part of the lyrics and say, oh yeah, that's me. I'm tough too. So that's gonna matter. That's gonna make a song resound over generations, such as this song has. Okay, so unlike most rock lyrics, the poetry actually scans here, which is to say that, look, nearly all the time, he is rigorous with the structure of stressed and unstressed syllables. Okay, so he's using what we call an anapest structure. That's two unstressed syllables followed by one stressed syllable. Okay, so I've already said the first line, but listen to it this way. She can kill with a smile. She can wound with her eyes, right? Two unstressed, one stressed. And that's throughout the song. Now, surely Joel knew this when he was trying to set the song to music, because he chooses a time signature, a rhythmic structure for the piece, in which three is the primary division. Now, I'm speaking of something called compound meter, and this is not the norm in pop or rock music. Now, it's not unheard of by any stretch, but I think it's less than 10% of the time if we were ever to figure out, put all of the songs through the time signatureometer. Yeah, I just made up that term. It doesn't exist. Anyway, I've had a couple of songs already in my series of videos that had this time signature, namely, well, Queen's Bicycle Race at one point, Dave Matthews' Stay or Leave at one point, and then what was the first one? Oh yeah, The Doors, People Are Strange. I'm going to try to explain it again with a little more of a mathematical, but a simple mathematical approach that I hope will make it clear. Okay, so there are three time signatures in this piece, not just one. Oh, I should also say, hey, usually we get one time signature at the beginning, no matter whether it's compound meter or other meters, and that's it. And we groove on that for the rest of the song. In this song, we get changes of time signature, which is strange enough by itself. But all three are types of compound meter. We have the time signature of 12/8, of 9/8, and of 6/8. Okay, so what's going on here? Compound meter, in general, means the beat divides into three. Not just three parts, three even parts, okay? So you have something happening at the beginning of the beat, a third of the way through, two-thirds of the way through, and then, well, it keeps going like that, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Something like that. Okay? Now, the opposite of this is much, much, much more common. It's called simple meter, and it's where the beat divides exactly in half. Dot, 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 dot. Nothing wrong with that. Okay, I got nothing against simple meter, and you can do a lot with that and more than I'm letting on, just because I don't have time to talk about it right now. However, the compound meter here is divided. The beat is divided into three, and it's not clear in the time signature what exactly that means. Okay, usually when you see a time signature, 2/4 or 3/4 or 4/4. Maybe you remember this from some music lessons a long time ago, but the top number is supposed to mean the number of beats in a measure. Okay? In compound meters, when you see 6, 9, or 12, that's not the case. Okay? Here's what I'd like you to do. When you see the 6, 9, or 12, divide by 3, and that's how many beats are in the measure. So here's what I mean. Look at my chart over here to the left. Compounds, time signatures, translated. Well, the quarter note is not our beat here. The dotted quarter note is the beat. So let's not worry about what that means for the moment. And when I mean dot, I mean it looks like a quarter note, and there's a dot just off to the right of the note head like that. It's not polka dotted, okay? One single dot. Anyway, there really are 4 beats occasionally, okay? However, those 4 beats are dividing into 3. What's 4 times 3? 12. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Or you could hear 3 beats in a measure, and each beat divides into 3. 3 plus 3 plus 3 is 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 1, 2, 3, etc. Or you will see 6, 8, and you hear 2 beats in a measure, and they're each divided into 3 for 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, that's what I mean by 12, 9, or 8. It's not giving you immediately the number of beats in a measure, but it's telling you the number of divisions in the measure. Okay, so if you take that 12 or that 9 or 6, divide by 3, you get the number of beats, and the lower number then, the 8 in 12, 8, 9, 8, or 6, 8, is that beat division. Okay, so there are 12 eighth notes here, and you can see how each of them lines up with one of my dotted quarter notes. A dotted quarter note is what you get then when you add 3 eighth notes together. Okay, so if that was fancy, I'm sorry. You'll hear it going through this song, in which you can count the whole way. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Okay, there's a further complication. However, Joel doesn't stop at that. He divides each division into 2. This is called subdividing, the fancy term. Okay, so what does that mean for the math here? Well, if the beat divides into 3, and each of those divide further into 2, okay, I don't have 6 fingers on my left hand to spread those out the right way there, but you get a division of 6 in a measure. So 3 further dividing into 2 more each gives you 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, okay? Now, when people think of the accompaniment in the song, what he's playing in the piano part, usually you remember the part where he does something like this. And something like. Something like that, okay? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, like that. Okay, now, we don't have to hear all 3 divisions of the beat to hear that the music is well structured. That's what the beat is for. But we will hear all 3, and sometimes we'll hear all 6, and sometimes we'll hear combinations of those. Okay, so there is deceptive complexity in the rhythmic structure here. So before I get into the further into the rhythm, actually. And groupings and patterns, I want to talk about the overall form for a second, because it's not standard. The most standard form in rock and pop music is something you may have heard of called verse-chorus form. Okay, our verses have the same music, but new words each time. Okay, so new words fit into the same melodies and harmonies. Okay, the chorus means there's a part where everyone sings together, or it's just louder if there's a single singer, and maybe higher voices, maybe there's more action going on. Maybe we get to shout out the name of the song at that point. Okay, there's no chorus here. We have what's called a refrain form. What I mean by that is you're going to hear in this song, every time he starts in one of these verses, same music, new words, it ends with the same cap, the same ending, okay? And that ending is our title. So I'm calling it the title refrain every time we get to it. She's always a woman to me. Here's what I mean. Let's listen to Billy do it, because would you believe he's a little bit better than I at singing and playing it. Here we go.
She hides like a child, but she's always a woman to me.
There you go. That's the title refrain, I'm going to call it. That ended the first verse. It's not long enough to be a chorus. It's only a few words, right? But that keeps coming back. Okay, so the word is refrain, and we hear it four times in the song. Okay, so it's not as long as a chorus, which also comes back the same way, but it's shorter, and it follows continuously from the verse. Now that's important because you don't really hear a new section start and, oh, well, we're clearly in this new thing called the chorus here. It's just the logical end, at least I hear it that way, of each verse. But that's not the only thing going on here. Twice along the way, he launches into a contrasting section. Without it, there would be no contrasting section, and he can get away with that. It does happen. But the contrasting section is called the bridge. So what did bridges do in music, if you've heard this term? I don't know. Think about leaving your hometown, and there were several ways you could get out, but only one way back in, and furthermore, it was a one-way street. So, and also it went over the train tracks, right? So there's a bridge that leads you back home. It leads you back to something you already know, and that's what exactly the bridge does when the term is used correctly. And I think I'm using the term correctly here, because we're going to hear Billy use it as a section without a really conclusive ending that suddenly takes a little turn and twists and ends up into, we end up back in another verse. Okay, so watch out for that when we get there. Okay, so more discussion then of the rhythm and what's going on with these time signatures I was alluding to. Well, I mentioned once before, usually when one hears the time signature and you can tell, oh, there are four beats in this measure, great. You can set your watch to it. Things will happen, whether you know it or not, whether you can say, oh, hey, four beats going on here. By the end of the song, you begin to feel that, hey, something's about to happen here, because that's just what the patterning does. Our brains are pattern-seeking organs. So Joel throws that out. He's got measures of two beats, of three beats, and of four beats in the song. Okay, so the first two measures we hear set up the pattern to be groupings of four. Okay, that's standard, very common, okay? In fact, let me hear here. He's going to play it. Ready? One, two, three, four. One, two, three,
she can kill with a smile.
Okay. Great. If you were expecting it to continue in four, he's going to throw, what's it called? A monkey wrench in the system? He's going to throw a monkey at the wrench? A wrench at the monkey? Not sure what the correct use of that. Yes, I'm being silly, of course. The next grouping is five. Let's go back. One, two, three, four. One, two, three.
She can kill with a smile.
One,
she can
two,
with her eyes.
Three, four,
she can
five. One, two, three, four, five. One, two, three, four.
She hides
one,
like a child,
two,
but she's
three,
always
four again.
To me.
One, two, three,
she can
four again. Okay, so he begins and ends with groupings of four. Okay, that's good. In the middle, there are two groupings of five. Now, rather than saying this is a measure with five beats, it usually doesn't work that way. Five divides into 2 + 3 or 3 + 2. Okay, now I know musicians have five fingers on each hand. But it's tough for us to count there. Honestly, we have trouble getting past four. So how do we get to five if we have to? 2 + 3 or 3 + 2. What's happening here, based on the emphasized notes here, is a pattern of two, then three. Okay? She can kill with a smile. She can wound with her eyes. And she can ruin your life with a I forget what. Wait. You're in whatever it is there. Okay. But yeah, there's the kill with the smile and one with her eyes. So 2 + 3, 3 = 5. How does he get away with this? Well, he's sticking an extra beat into or in between the third and what would have been the third and fourth beat to get a new total of 5. Here's what I mean. Billy, do it.
She can ruin your
Ah.
day.
Here we go.
She can kill with a
One,
smile. She can
two.
wound with her
One,
eyes.
two,
And she can ruin
three.
your faith
One,
with her
two.
casual
One,
lies.
two,
And she
three.
only knows
One,
what she
two.
wants you
And then we're
to.
back to four. Now, looking at the example over here, it might not be immediately clear what's going on. When he says she can kill with a smile, it doesn't really count. I know you're saying, wait a second, you're trying to explain this to me in plain English, and then you tell me the first thing I hear from his voice is something that doesn't count. Sorry. It doesn't. It's all moving forward to smile. Okay? She can kill with a smile. Smile really starts the beginning of the beat, the counting structure. And why do I say that? Well, look, he already told us there are 4 beats in a measure from the introduction, the piano accompaniment. Check it out. One, two, three. Here's four. Back to one. One, two, three. Here's
She can
four.
kill with a
And back to one.
smile. She
Okay, so those sounds going by that we've already heard before he even says a thing tell us that kill with a smile is leading to smile. Okay, that's the beginning. Kill with a smile, she can wound with her eyes, and she can ruin your. It's the and she can ruin where he stops the piano part. He had been very clear about the beat in the piano part. So not much happening there. But when he gets to she can wound with her eyes, he stops for a second. He play it takes 2 beats. So here's the extra beat I think he's adding in there that gets us to 5 or 2 + 3, however you want to look at it. Now look, I don't know how he wrote it down. I think this is the better way to hear it. Oh, and if you go online and look up, sheet music for this, you're going to see other ways people have decided to notate it because it is tricky. I'm going to give him that. Okay, so what's going on here? This is not common that we should have grouping beats, measures with groupings of 5 in them before we get the new idea. Well, first of all, this was the 70s. Early 70s, we had something called prog rock that was attractive to a lot of musicians. Okay, whether they liked it or not, it perked their ears up and they wanted to try it. And so we get stuff like this happening at this time. Hey, Journey, before they had Steve Perry, had a song. And I want to say 1975, called Nickels and Dimes, with a grouping of 5 like this. So yeah, there was that, but that can't be it. Okay, let's ask why and look in the lyrics to find out why. She can kill with a smile, she can wound with her eyes. Okay, he wants us to deal with the effects here that our woman is not I don't know, Little Miss Sunshine. Okay? What did I write? Oh, he wants us to contend with her sociopathic qualities because it's a little contradictory. The accompaniment, very simple. Okay, and then when he starts adding the 16th notes I was telling you about. Flowing accompaniment that sounds gentle at the same time the words are, well, abrasive or dangerous. Okay, so I think that's the reason we have a measure in 5 and then another one after that because there's more than meets the eye, more than meets the ear here. I'd like to ruin it and squeeze it back into 4/4. Ready? She can kill with a smile, she can moon with her eyes, and she can ruin your faith with her casual lies. She only reveals what she. Do you hear how that's all? Okay, you know the song. You can hear how that's constricted now. It's not how he intended to be. It has more room to breathe in the example or in the final product he wrote. But if we tried to dance a pattern to this, which we probably would not, but if we did, our feet would get mixed up because there's no five pattern with dancing. Come on. It's more complex than that. She's more complex. The woman is more complex than that. That's what I'm trying to get at here. Okay, so let's get to the refrain, the title refrain here. He has two of these groupings in five, but then he ends up saying, and she only reveals what she wants you to see. She hides like a child, but she's always a woman to me. So back to two groupings of four. Great. The music literally settles into four here because, well, we have the point of it all here, that she's always a woman to me. So no matter what I just said, he's saying in my ear, my interpretation, no matter what I just said about her, doesn't matter because she's always a woman to me. And when he says woman, he doesn't say one kind of woman. He says woman as in woman herself, as in womanhood, as in, well, femininity. And I can't help but think he doesn't mean something, or that he means something like a woman just like every other woman, or a woman just as good as every other woman, or maybe even better. Anyway, so she hides like a child, but she's always a woman to me. Great. At that moment, he has an overlap with the next verse, okay? So at that moment, he gets into... And she can lead you to love in the next verse, okay? No stop and then start over. Oh, he takes a breath, sure, but the music keeps going. It forms an overlap. The end, she's always a woman to me, corresponds with the beginning of the harmony moving forward in a new group of four. And yeah, there will be groups of five in that verse as well. Okay, so when I was talking about the rhythm and how he's emphasizing the important words, like she hides like a child, but she's always a woman to me, it's more than that. It would be a little boring if he had every important syllable land directly on the beat. So what he does is something called between the beat syncopation. That's right, syncopation. Here's how you spell it over here if you were wondering. There we go. Syncopation. There, I'll leave it in blue for a second. Okay, this means, well, okay, there are different kinds of syncopation. This is not new. He didn't invent it in this song. It's been around for 1,000 years at least. But what it means is an emphasis with the rhythm where you wouldn't expect it. Okay, so if he sets up the rhythm to have this clear beat, and all of a sudden there's something in between that, at the expense of the beat. Maybe we hear it a little earlier. It doesn't quite line up before or after. Either way, syncopation between the beat. Okay, so this one is particularly sophisticated because he spends time trying to get the sixteenth note to be emphasized. Okay, at the expense of the next 16th note, which would be the beginning of the next measure. This is what I mean. Look at the chart here. She can kill with a smile. Do you see how smile is on this 16th note, just barely before the beat starts here, right after it, where I've got this piano chord and it says E flat. Okay, she can kill with a smile. Smile is just before how I played. Maybe your ear tried to put it back on, but it's not, it's before. Smile. She can kill with a smile. She can wound with her eyes. Same thing with eyes. Just before the piano part, that's on the beat, okay? Just as he promised from the introduction, that remains on the beat. He's getting there just barely early with important words in his lyrics. She can ruin your faith. Now, faith is on the beat. Okay, so it doesn't, it's not exclusively this pattern, but then he gets to it again with her casual lies, or what, casual lies. There it is up there. So the lies is just before another harmony, and she only reveals the reveals. The veil of reveal is just before another chord. She only reveals what she wants you to see. It's a technique that is not sloppy, even though the way I did it might seem sloppy. When the good musicians do it, it sounds like the music is unsettled. Not unsettled in an, oh, what the hell is going on here way, but unsettled in a subtle way, such that returning to music then on the beat shortly after this, which he will do, okay? Returning to music on the beat then will be settled, will be stable compared to just a little bit of instability. Can you hear him do it? Because again, strangely enough, he's so much better at this than I am. Here we go.
She can kill with a smile, she can wound with her eyes, and she can ruin your faith with her casual lies, and she only reveals what she wants you to see.
And then C is on the beat again. Okay. It's not just in the first verse, it's in each verse. And it's not on every single measure, beginning of a measure, but on most. Okay, syncopation, when done properly, feels like the song is leaning forward a little bit, rather than sitting down on every beat and lounging around. You get the sense that there's more to come, the rhythm not quite settling on the beat, is a little out of phase with it, and then when it does get back onto the beat, sounds satisfyingly stable. Okay, so when does he do that? Well, she's always a woman to me. Here we go.
She hides like a child, but she's always a woman to me.
Me, and the... Okay, so there, where is it here? Oh, well, I had it earlier. So, me lands on the beat. Furthermore, she hides like a child, but she's always a woman to... a woman and me, right? The two characters here, right? The voice and the object, the woman here. I didn't mean he's objectifying her. I mean just the object of his ode on the beat. Okay? Subtle, hard to hear, but just enough. Whether you hear it or not, whether you can articulate it or not as, hey, what's going on there? Is that some of that syncopation off the beat right there? No. It's one of those things that it adds up over time and you feel like, yeah, no, but oh, here, it seems to really come together. And that's what he's trying to do. Okay, so moving on, what I want to talk about then is that first verse in another way, because look, we hear four verses in the song. It's important. And I want to talk about now the melody and harmony. This music is in E flat major. That's the E flat major scale, and furthermore, E flat's the most important note, and furthermore, chord based on E flat, it's called E flat major, is the most important triad. Great, so that's what we hear harmonically, but melodically, okay, what he's singing, she can kill with her eyes. Was it smile? Yeah, kill with her smile, right? It's hanging on G, and she can wound with her eyes. It's hanging on G. Not E flat, but G. No problem. I have no problem with that. Sounds good. Why not? However, E flat over an E with an E flat harmony would be stable. She can kill with her smile. She can wound with her eyes. Boring. Possible, but it's not as dynamic as the first is. She can kill with her smile. She can wound with her eyes. It's the G, okay? starts on it, coming and goes a little part away from it, a little higher, a little lower, back to the G. So that's what my little chart is showing. Just the most important harmony. E flat with my smile, and she can wound with her eyes, the G. Now, he takes that music, the music we just heard with Killing Smiles and all that, and moves it up a perfect fourth. She can, what is it? Ruin your faith with her, your faith with a casual eyes. Up there, higher than I can sing. Sorry, I'm a piano player. Okay, it's the same music, higher. And C is the most important note over this harmony. And faith and ruin with her casual eyes. There it is. Okay, so what's the relationship between these first two things? Well, it's not clear which is more important. The first hangs out on G, the next suddenly higher on C. It's not clear what's going to happen next, okay? There's a statement and a higher version. It's called a transposition, when the same music comes back higher or lower. What does happen? Well, she only reveals what she wants you to see. Now, this is back where he started. And she only reveals what she wants you to see. So here's that G back on reveals. What she wants you to see. Aha! The G is still there, but the harmony changed. We're expecting another E-flat wants you to see. And we're expecting another E-flat harmony. But he plays a G major harmony. Wants you to see. Unexpected. This is the first time he's left the key of E-flat major. E-flat major has B naturals in it. Sorry, B-flats in it. There it is, B flat. Now we have B natural right there. Okay, now it's not supposed to sound, ew, what is he doing there? No, no, it's supposed to catch your ear. It's supposed to make you say, wait, what just happened? And lean in a little bit, whether you realize it or not, it perks your ears up. You know, like the dog lying on the floor, hears something out, people walking outside, the dog doesn't get up, but the ears go up a little bit. That's what I'm saying. Yeah, you're the dog here. I'm saying you can hear a something, even if you can't articulate. Oh, that's the G major harmony right there. That doesn't matter. Okay? You hear a harmony that is surprising, because it's not something we've heard yet, and it's remotely related to what we have heard. Okay, so that destabilizes the music. That was previously stable. And the melody's still on G, by the way. Still on G. Okay, so look, that's why I've decided to extend this line. See this big fat line on top I've got here? To extend that from the original G's through the box that I'm now calling just parenthetical. And then he picks up that G again. Okay, so why did he have the parenthetical two measures over here? Well, we'll find out later. More on that. So he's back to G. What she wants you to see, and she hides like a child, but she's always a woman to me. Okay, he finally gets off that G. We've had enough of that G. He gets off of the G and it moves to F, and she hides like a child, but she's always a woman to me. Now, that's not the only note there. When she hides like a child, let's look at some of those notes. Where is it? Here we go. She hides like a child, but she's always a woman to me. There's D and E and F and even a couple G's in there, okay? The music is spinning around F until it drops to me, to E flat, and the E flat is part of our E flat harmony, so we've been away from E flat for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 beats now. That's not that long, but it's far enough away from it that we haven't heard it in a while, and it sounds refreshing. It sounds stabilizing. It sounds like the music has settled into place there, because now we have an E flat with an E flat harmony there. Not the G, but now it went through F and to E flat. Okay, this is no accident. Joel knows what he's doing. He knows harmony. Like, I've looked at a lot of his songs. He actually writes some pretty strange, far out stuff occasionally. But he knew what he was doing from listening to lots of songs, lots and lots of songs from many eras, including Beethoven and Mozart and Bach and, well, all kinds of stuff. Okay, so that's what he's doing with pitch. Introducing an important note, G, going elsewhere, coming back to the G, and then destabilizing the G before he moves to F, and F, and F, and E. He's stepping down at the end of this section to make for a conclusive ending. Not so conclusive that the song would end. Notice the moment he gets to me, the piano picks up and starts moving. And notice at the same time, the guitars will come in. There are two acoustic guitars here that do not have a prominent part. I haven't notated them here because they're really not that important. They sort of keep the rhythm spinning along because his piano part is not going to keep going in 16ths. He's going to play combinations of other things. So, now that I've said that, can we hear this going on in the verse? Oh, and listen to the overlap with the next verse. Here we go.
She can warm with her
G.
Eyes. She can
up to C. Back to G.
She knows what she wants you to see.
Now to
she hides F. like a child, but she's always a woman to me.
E flat. Overlap.
She can leave you.
Beautiful, isn't it, right? He could have ended that. Always a woman to me. Taking a breath, and then everybody. I don't know, he probably wouldn't have shouted that out there. But okay, he could have stopped and started again. Probably still would have been a big hit. I love the overlap right there. Oh, and he didn't invent that either. It's common practice. However, it's done so perfectly right there. As the new instruments come in. Oh, and the bass guitar comes. Stegmeier's bass comes in as well at that point. Okay, so let's talk about the bridge here. He's been singing fairly low for him. He's a low tenor. He's not a screaming high tenor. But he's certainly not a bass, and he sings around middle C, but he's been down here. Now, I'm a bass. I really am a bass. But I'm able to sing this because it's in the low tenor range. Finally, he breaks out of that into a much higher note. Oh, she takes care of herself. Sorry about the singing. I'm a piano player. We'll have him do it. He sounds much better at it in a second. Okay, so that's the first contrast. We hear his voice higher. Okay, the second contrast is we have a new harmony at the beginning, C minor. And different harmonies after that, but the C minor is new. Okay, long note, our longest note of the song, the oh, she takes care of herself. These longer notes on the beginning of each measure. Okay, that's something. The other new thing here is something we call a sequence. Now, here's one of those fancy music terms that I'm going to try to teach you in a few seconds, and I think you'll be able to handle it. A sequence in music is when we hear the same segment of music. Usually it's only two bars, maybe four, repeated, a step up or a step down, right afterwards. And then usually, more often than not, repeat it again. Another step up or another step down. Okay, now along the way there might be micro changes in there. It doesn't matter. Overall, you hear music getting higher and higher or lower and lower. And the music is not just any old music. It's related to the first statement and it comes back a little lower and a little lower. Now, surely he got this from studying Bach and Beethoven at the piano as a kid. He must have known this. This is too much like the sequences that they would have done. Okay, so when we listen to this in a second, look at the notes I had, or the harmonies and the melody notes for that matter, I have here in boxes. Okay, just the beginnings of the measure. Oh, she takes care of herself. The self is lower. Here was O. Here was self. She can wait if she wants. Again, sorry about the singing. But that's, he's stepping down. That's, and then here. So look, there's stuff in between there. I know, there's other harmonies even in between there. But the pattern at the beginning of each measure, my boxes here, if we compare them, are stepping down. Okay, now he breaks that pattern. He doesn't keep doing that. In fact, the standard thing to do with sequences is to break it during the third time. So you get 2.5 statements. Statement one, statement two a little higher, the third statement even higher, and then just when you start thinking, hey, I know what's going to happen here, it's going to keep getting, oh, wait, it stopped. And that's exactly the point. Joel, following many, many, many musicians, jazzers do this all the time, start a pattern so that you think it's going to keep going and then change it. Okay, so that's exactly what he does here. He changes it, it gets out of that, and we hear, what do we hear? Now we hear, going to, she's ahead of her time. There, that's the end of the first half of the bridge. Not the whole bridge, the first half of the bridge, okay? So we're back. Back to E flat. And it reminds us we're back to E flat with those first two chords. Remember those chords? Okay, great. Contrast, came back to E flat. Here's where it gets strange. He plays the bridge music as we've heard it again, but now everything transposed up a minor third. So when we first heard C minor, moving eventually to B flat major to A flat major, the second time through, without warning, suddenly we have E flat minor. She takes care of herself and she never gives in. I forget, she just changes her mind. Something like that. It's the same music, higher. He gets, she never gives out. Okay, so the harmonies are E flat minor. Okay, E flat minor is related to E flat major, our original chord, right? But what he's going to do here is introduce harmonies then that are related to the E flat minor scale, which is not the same as the E flat major scale, and take us into what we call the flat areas. Okay, the music, they're called flat areas because some of the notes are a step lower, a half step lower actually, than they would be in major. Now, that might seem pretty subtle, but overall it sounds like the music is a little depressed. Okay, but check it out. The dynamic tension here is the whole thing is higher. So usually when music is higher, there is more urgency, a sense of trying to get somewhere faster perhaps, or at least the vocal strain, the vocal intensity, for lack of a better word, is evident. But we get chords like E flat minor, D flat major, and you heard it from me, C flat major. Yeah.
She just changes her mind.
And then he with a slight little harmonic sleight of hand, he's back to E flat major after that. Let's hear him do it. Okay, so this will be in the middle of the second verse.
Feels like a thief, but she's always a woman. Refrain. To me.
Here we go. The bridge coming up. First half. There's the first half. Okay, we got back to E flat. No problem. Nice. There was contrast. Here's what's shocking, that suddenly we get E flat minor without warning, without smooth transition.
Promise you more than
there we go. Verse 3 after that. Let's spend a little bit more time with the bridge here. If you still are not sure what I'm talking about, it's easiest to hear what's going on by just listening to the bass. Four note pattern. Here's where it begins. Oh, and she takes care of herself. Dum, da, da. Now lower, down, and lower, and lower again. Gets out of it, E flat. Okay, the second half, the same thing starts, but a little higher. Here's four notes, descending. One, two, three, four, lower. One, two, three, four, lower. One, two, three, four, one, That's how it's easier to hear, I think. If you can somehow filter out what's going on in the voice and just listen to the beginning of each measure, I think it's easy to hear. And that's what I've put in the boxes here. But yeah, very clear in the bass here. Stegmeier's bass. Well, it's Joel's left hand and Stegmeier's bass following his lead. Furthermore, there's another instrument here. It's a little flute in the background. Okay, what do flutes do? Not really a rock and roll instrument, Jethro Tull notwithstanding, right? Well, it's got a soft, gentle sound. It's breathy, right? He's using it here, in my opinion, in my ear, to because he's talking about more positive personality characteristics or her softer side. Okay, and he's maybe that's why he's singing in a higher vocal range too, with longer notes. We get some redeeming features here. Not that she wasn't completely irredeemable before, but at this point it sounds like he's trying to say better things about her. She can take care of herself. She can wait if she wants, right? And she's ahead of her time. All three good things, right? She never gives out, never gives in. She just changes her mind, right? She doesn't care that she may not have been correct. She's changed her mind, and you got to deal with it, okay? So that's what I think is going on here. We have a section of music clearly contrasting because we get a little more information about the woman, more positive information to compare with overwhelmingly, well, yeah, I said sociopathic, and I'm not sure I'm wrong. Okay, so what do we get after that? Well, here, you know what we get. It's called.
In the Garden of Eden.
There we go. Verse 3. Notice, by the way, he says she can promise you more than the Garden of Eden. Yeah, there was a woman in the Garden of Eden. She caused some trouble. She was by definition the best woman on earth at the time, by the way. So look, it's no accident that he went biblical here to talk about his woman because she's important. She ranks up there with Eve. I'm surprised he doesn't mention something like Aphrodite or, Joan of Arc. Anyway, we get our third verse. Okay, new words, same melody, same accompaniment, same harmonies. We get a repeat of the bridge section, right? Great. Just as we heard before, same shape, same harmonies, that kind of thing. And then we get, you guessed it, a fourth verse. Okay, so why should this be ver why should we listen to a fourth verse? Aren't we tired of this by now? I think he knows that. I think he knows it. I think he's well aware of that. And that's why he's going to change it. Here we go. Fourth verse.
And she never gives
Well, that's the second bridge. Here we go. Fourth verse. Final verse.
She's frequently kind and she's suddenly cruel. She can go where she pleases. She's nobody's fool. And she can't be convicted. She's earned her degree.
Here we go.
And the most she will do is throw shadows at you, but she's always a woman to me.
What happened there? Well, it was the same first with the first two phrases with the groupings of five, then we get a grouping of four. Okay. When she can't be convicted, she's earned her degree, so we know what's going to happen, right? There's going to be another grouping of four, but there's not. A grouping of six. And the six is four plus two. Or should I say, it's four with two stuck in the middle here before we get to the last one for a total of six. Yeah, I'm really doing that. See? Four plus two here. The last beat, he separates the third and the fourth beat and puts two new harmonies in there to make the overall drive to that ending a little stronger. He gets more words out and he makes his point that this is different. Listen to this. Why should we listen to that, Billy? Well, it's the end. Here. Check it out. It should be four beats. Here we go.
She can go where she pleases. She's nobody's fool. And she can't
One,
be
two,
convicted. She's earned
three,
her
four. We
degree.
expect another four.
And the most
One,
she will
2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1. And we're back to that. Okay, so in the box here, over my chart to the left, I've got the two extra beats. In between where, if I took this out, that would have been the same harmonic progression we had before, but there it is. It's in there. Okay, it's not just that, though. He just didn't get stuck. He didn't forget where he was in the metric structure. No, he knew this was different, and he changed the melody as well. Okay, so instead of, and the most she will do is throw shadows at you, but she's always a woman to me. That would have been boring. That would have been six beats on this E and this F that he keeps trying to bring down to E flat, right? No, no. What he does is start up on C, B flat, flat, E, C. Oh, yes, I know. Phone. I know I have to do that. The most she will do is throw shadows at you. It's too high. And the most she will do is throw shadows at you, but she's always a woman to me. When he gets back down to the title words, the refrain, yeah, that's where we've heard it. And he ends it like he did before. But what's with this stuff? The most she will do is throw shadows at you. It's too high. Or is it? I argue that, remember that the first time he was singing and he was stuck down here. She's da 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 da, and when she'll killing with her smile and that kind of thing, right? And then she'll ruin your faith with her casual lies. That was up on C and B flat and C. Here it is, it's back. And the most she will do is throw shadows at you, but then it's back down. She's always a woman to me. He's combining earlier elements of the song, the higher range and the lower range, to make a better ending here, whether he knew it or not. Look, Billy, would love to talk to you if you ever want to get in touch, if you find yourself watching videos about your music sometime. But please let me know. I'm easy to find on the internet. But I suspect whether you did it on purpose or not, something in your intuition probably latched onto the fact that earlier you were singing higher, and then you settled back to G, and now this time you want to make a better ending by combining both those two ideas. Okay, so again, listen to how surprising it is, but somehow not so surprising that you walk away and say, what the hell is this? It sounds like, yeah, wait, that's okay. That's good. We've heard that before, sort of. Okay. Here's the section that's higher. She's nobody's fool. So he's up here on C. Back to G. Back to C. And the most she will do is throw shadows at you. Back to G. To G through F and to E flat. Great. Great ending, right? It's not the ending. What does he do? Well, he gives you what sounded like the beginning of another verse. There we go. But then he starts humming. He hums the same melody as the second half of the verse. Sort of. It's not everything's in there. It's sort of a skeletal, but are the notes he just sang with words, but here it is wordless. Okay, now it also doesn't have the extra two beats. He just gets right into always a woman to me, except it's wordless, so you're supposed to fill it in with your ear, and you can, because you've heard it several times. You've heard it four times already. She's always a woman to me, right? So he's counting on you to remember what the song is about and fill in the lyrics here, and it works. It makes you think, it makes you remember earlier into the song. He doesn't have to say it again. He's said it enough. Why say it again? Furthermore, the high notes are back. The higher notes I suggested that really didn't quite belong before, but that he was adding in there, are now repeated. So it's a way of justifying it by repeating, doing it again. And then the song really ends. Okay? I think it would have been too abrupt if he ended before that. Here. if this were the ending right here, wait.
And the most she will do is throw shadows at you, but she's always a woman to me.
Thank you. Good night, everybody. It's too abrupt. The instruments were still going. Did you hear them? They kept rolling along in 16th notes, and they have for some time. So what he does is repeat this ending, but then he takes the piano to a part where it slows down to... And... Okay, so he doesn't run into a wall at the end. He slows down. Okay. He goes to a walk and then sits down at the very end. We know it's ending the second time. We haven't heard the refrain played twice, and the refrain, such as it is, always is an ending, right? I said it caps the verse. It does again here, and then to play it again. If you were wondering, this really sounds like an end. Yeah. He really intended this to sound final. And it works. And it slows things down a little bit. The energy dissipates. It was going too fast, or at least with too many things going around in the guitars and piano. And it seems to come to a gentle rest. Okay, so overall, he's writing a late 70s mellow ballad. It wasn't the only one on this album. There was the bigger hit was actually Just the Way You Are, if you remember that. But it's not just a ballad. It's not just the way you are. Or maybe he's singing to the same woman. I don't know. But it's got some strangeness and some twists and turns along the way, because she's a complex cat. She's more than just a woman, to quote a Bee Gees song from what might be the same year. Okay, so, yeah, I can't help but thinking he's describing the modern woman in general, and perhaps, as I mentioned before, that's why the song has endured. But I'll tell you what, it probably would not have endured if he did not spend so much time caring for the melodic shape, the exact harmonies, right? And the new section, the contrast, bringing the instruments in the right time, slowing down at the end, bringing his voice up when it needed to and down when it needed to. It wouldn't be the same song with a simple accompaniment. It might still have been a hit, because he had so many hits off that album, I know, but I'm very grateful that he spent this much time beforehand and then in the studio getting it right with this specific musical setting. Because it goes a long way to describing the woman in ways that just the lyrics might not be able to do. Thank you for your time and attention. Please check back soon. I'll be adding new videos, hopefully early next week.